The Revolutionary Etude by Chopin, number Opus 10, number 12. And this is a piece that I've been recently asked to work on. I realize I think it's one of the first pieces I ever taught, but I never actually learned it. So now I'm spending a little bit of time, hopefully, probably over the holidays, just looking at this piece. So starting at the beginning of this, probably any pianist will realize that, like I did myself, this is a bit of a problem in the left hand. And if we don't have really a good strategy or fingering or some kind of approach, even if we're wrong, we need to be applying what we know about technique and how to play to any circumstance. So, in this case, what looks like a wheel, right? We have all these wheels. And I would recommend that you use the fingering like in the Paderewski edition. Use the fingerings 2-1, 2-4. Those are good fingerings. So always have the 2 where you have the accents. 4-3-1-2, 4-3-1-2, 4-3-1-2. And start with 2-1. You're going to have to do this the other places also, like here, you know, where it goes, start with a 2-1-2, and then elsewhere as well. So it's a kind of strange wheel, but by doing it we realize that the 2, which we have a place for, 2-1-2-4-3-1-2-4-3-1-2-4-3-1-2-4-2-2, the 2 is always down. The wrist is down because we're at the part of the wheel that's going like this. So it's going like that. And we're more up on the 3. See the 3 where we start, or 2 rather, depending what finger you put there. You can start with a 3. 3-1-2. 3-2. Up, down, 3-2. Then another thing that's really, this is another tool on its own, but maybe one of the most important ways, actually, we should make another video on this, the most important way to practice, maybe, I don't want to say it's the most important way, but it's definitely a really essential tool, is to group things together rhythmically. And you can try doing it in different ways to see which way feels best. And sometimes it's not just one way. So sometimes this, if I'm going to be perfectly honest with you, I feel like this is the type of practicing that has always made it possible for me to play something, let's say, that was technically difficult or virtuose. So in this case, what I would recommend is to start by doing this one. It might feel like you're putting an accent on the 4th finger here, and that's okay for the moment. It's just a practice to get this grouping, ta-ga-da-dum. But it's the wheel in the right hand, in the left hand. Then you can try the same movement as this, the same technique that you used to do this, but to go putting an accent now. So yes, it takes patience. And then this is rotation. It does take patience to do this sort of practice, but it's something that I would say is underestimated. When you come to my masterclass and we start to work on something like this, chances are you're practicing it and completely underestimating how good of a practice this has been, even if it seems a little bit tedious. Then you come back to this. It seems easy for the first time. So that's one of the tools that you might be using in a lot of places. Same thing would apply if you have, like, in the right hand. The technique of the right hand is something that you may have overlooked as well. Let's say if this is very easy or very difficult, rather, and you have to spend already a lot of time working on this, you might start doing this instead of, or maybe that's something you haven't learned to do yet. So using the speed of attack with the weight inside this attack. Are you attacking more here? Are you attacking more here? More here in the middle? This is everything we're working on. So there's ways of doing that depending on the technique or different things that you might have learned from different teachers up to this point on the different ways of doing this. You know, the way I learned in Canada is to do this. And this is a great exercise. I mean, this should be like the exercise. We're gonna make another video on this exercise. But this is basically your body is moving forward and you're following through. Some other teachers will teach from here. And the European way of teaching is more like using the arms this way as if you're plucking a string. They all have different effects and efficiencies depending on the situation you might be applying this to, or just how well you know to do one or the other. But essentially they're doing something very similar. They're allowing you to make your attack inside of this. So another thing that I might assume, just like we're looking for things to improve, we're hunting for little problems, maybe this is something, is what can I look at on a rhythmic level? Maybe I'm forgetting something. Often it might be your experience that you learn a piece and you find at some point that you're doing a lot of rubatos and things that maybe don't make sense, or you think they make sense, but in general the whole piece doesn't make sense. So your rubatos make sense, but the piece doesn't make sense anymore. Maybe something's wrong. So you come back to using a metronome. Use a metronome, and you find that it's like really weird to put the metronome on. There's places you were speeding up that you didn't realize, slowing down, you didn't realize that was like much faster or something like that. But parts of the piece is like, nah, I can't play with a metronome, of course not. There's things that you have to like slow down here. It even says so. Fine, perfectly fine. But do it anyway, and you might find that there's also places where playing a little more in tempo, a little less rubato, is actually very appropriate. Or you might even like change your strategies of slowing down and where to take time by doing this exercise. You might find that you rediscover the piece that actually makes sense, and then you can put your rubato around the general structure of the piece. So that's another thing you might do. That's another kind of thing using the rhythm. Another thing that you can do using the rhythm, this is another tool in your toolbox, is say, well, let's look at the beats in the bar and how this might apply in a general level. So for example, are the first beats always the most important? Can I create a movement towards the middle of the bars? How does that feel? That's one of my favorites lately, especially. very interesting thing to do in this piece. So these are some things we have to consider. Most of the time, depending on the type of piece, if you're playing a waltz, well, then you have three beats. So it's no longer, it's not the third beat anymore, it's the second beat. And sometimes that might be interesting, or sometimes the third beat is interesting. The first beat is obviously of utmost importance in a waltz. So that's another strategy. Another thing, let's say this is just not working at all. It should be working if you practice like this. You can do things like this. Very helpful. And see, if I'm not able to do it super well, even if it's harder because it's different, maybe there's some more things to improve on a technical level in this thing. So I would probably, on a memorizational level, I realize, aha, I don't really know the fingerings by heart. That's why I couldn't do it. Now it's becoming really easy. Now it starts to feel like, oh my, what used to be like something that was such a problem for maybe any pianist, it's becoming really easy by doing these kind of practices. So that's it for the Revolutionary Etude number 10 by Chopin for now. But this is definitely something we're going to be back with and look into more detail.